Welcome to See the Mountain's brand new Science Revision channel. My name's Lewis Stewart and I'm here to guide you through AQA Science GCSE. In this video, we're starting with Physics Topic 1, Energy. All you need is a paper and a pen. Just follow along. Ready to learn in 3, 2, 1, let's go. Okay, folks, so following along with me now, please. On your paper, the centre title is energy, and we're going to put 9 to 1, that's our qualification. Now, I'm starting by listing the 9 main energy stores that we learn about in GCSE physics. So that's kinetic energy, gravitational potential energy, elastic energy, thermal energy, nuclear energy, internal energy, electrical energy, light energy, and sound energy. So kinetic energy is the energy stored in moving objects, where gravitational potential energy are objects, or is the energy stored in objects with mass above the surface of the Earth. Elastic energy is the energy stored in stretched objects, and thermal energy is stored in objects that have temperature. Nuclear energy, normally coming from nuclear fission or fusion reactions. Internal energy is a weird one, it's worth knowing about. It is the sum total of kinetic energies and potential energies of particles in a system. And it can also be referenced when we're talking about things to do with our human bodies losing energy as we transfer energy to different stores. Next, we have electrical energy. That's energy transferred by electrical charge. Light energy, any object that emits light. And then sound energy for vibrating objects. So next up, we're looking at energy transfers. Now, energy transfers apply in systems. A system is a group of objects, a key definition in GCSE science. We need to know about closed systems. In a closed system, no energy can enter or leave. So if I trap my nephew in a box and no energy can get in or out, I can call that system a closed system. Next is an open system, where energy can enter or leave. Now, in this system, we're looking at a pendulum. That's just any kind of swinging object. So if I pick up my nephew and swing him back and forth, that would make a pendulum. In the pendulum I've drawn on screen here, there are a few objects to be aware of. So that includes the ball, the string, the fixed point, the point it's attached to, and the surrounding air particles. Now, on the screen now, you'll see I'm labelling some of the key parts of the system of a pendulum. So in the system of a pendulum, some bits you need to know. Gravitational potential energy is always a maximum in any system where the object is at its highest point. As the pendulum swings and falls, it transfers to the kinetic energy store, and that will be at a maximum at the lowest point. And then kinetic energy is then transferred back to the potential energy store as it swings back again. Now, it is absolutely worth noting that there is energy dissipation in this system. Energy can be dissipated due to friction, happening at the fixed point, so the thermal energy generated will dissipate to the surroundings. We can minimize any unwanted energy transfers in the systems, usually in one of two ways, by lubricating and by removing air particles. Removing air particles will minimize work done against friction from those air particles, and the same for lubrication. Remember, always mention about energy being stored, work being done against a force, and then finally, if there is any thermal energy or sound energy, that is always dissipated. That's key exam language. All right, up next, we're going into the world of calculating energy. So we're going to look at three examples. Example number one, we're going to be looking at calculating gravitational potential energy. So let's go straight in with that one. So what I'm doing here is the gravitational potential energy stored in a person going down a slide first. So I'm giving you the mass of the person being 80 kilograms. Gravity on planet Earth is 9.81 newtons per kilogram, and this person seems to be on a slide that is about 10 meters high. So I've started off by naming the equation, and that is the gravitational potential energy is equal to mass times gravity times height. And I've put the units underneath each of those. So the units for mass is always kilograms, gravity is newton per kilogram, and height in meters. All right, so I'm going to start by substituting the values into the equation. So substituting the values in, mass gets replaced for 80, gravity gets replaced for 9.81, and height in this case was 10 meters. Timesing those three numbers together on a calculator gives us the gravitational potential energy of 7,848 joules. Now, I can divide that by 1,000 to convert that into kilojoules, and that would give me a value of 7.848 kilojoules. In the next system, I have my Nan's skull, have the mass of 2 kilograms, and I'm very kindly kicking it into Catherine's head. I'm kicking my man's skull at a velocity of 30 meters per second. So in this system, I'm going to try and calculate the kinetic energy transferred via my nan's skull to Catherine's head. So to do this, I recall the kinetic energy equation, and that is 0.5 times by the mass times by velocity squared. So I'm going to substitute the values in. So the mass of my nan's skull is 2 kilograms. That's going to go where the m was. That's why I put the number 2. And then the velocity of the skull was 30 meters per second, and that gets substituted where the v is. Don't forget to square that number. So that's 0.5 multiplied by 2 multiplied by 900, and the kinetic energy comes out as 900 joules. All right, next one. This is kind of more for the higher paper, but they absolutely will ask this right up to, you know, a maximum of 5 to 6 marks at GCSE. They often ask you to find the maximum velocity of a falling object. Now, to do this one, we take the gravitational potential energy stored in the object, and we need to make it equal to the kinetic energy. We're assuming that all the gravitational potential energy gets transferred to kinetic energy. So I've got a new system underway here. It seems like I've got a bed of spikes with some snakes, and I'm going to be pushing Catherine off of a cliff. So what we're going to do is find the maximum velocity of Catherine just before she hits the spiky snake bed. Alright, so as we push her off, we need to know some key bits of information. So if we're finding the maximum velocity, we're going to need to know the gravitational potential energy stored in Catherine before she falls. So I'm going to nicely assume her mass to be 50 kilograms and the height of this cliff 20 meters. Step one, I'm going to find the gravitational potential energy stored in her before she jumps, falls. So, the gravitational potential energy, substituting the values in, mass for 50, gravity for 9.81, and height for 20 meters. Timesing those three numbers together gives us a value of 9,810 joules. Once again, I could convert that to kilojoules if I wanted by dividing by 1,000. That's 9.82 significant figures. Step two, I make the gravitational potential energy equal to the kinetic energy. So 9,810 joules is now equal to half times by the mass times by velocity squared. Step one, I'm going to divide both sides of the equation by 1/2. Now that's going to be the same as timesing by 2, so that's why the number changes from 9,810 to 19,620 joules. In the next step, I make that equal to mass times velocity squared. The step after that, you'll see that I substitute the mass back in. That was 50, so 19,620 joules is equal to v squared. And then finally, dividing 19,620 by 50 gets me down to 392.4. Remember, that's equal to v squared though, so I just need to do one more insy-weensy step, and that is square root both sides. Now, what I'm showing you next on the side to the right is that the maximum velocity never depends on mass. They will ask you to explain why the maximum velocity does not depend on mass for 3 marks, yet weirdly, you don't actually write anything in terms of an explanation. You have to show this series of steps here. So what I've done first, I've put mgh equal to half mv squared. I've noticed mass is on both sides of the equality and cancelled out the m. That leaves me just with GH equals half watts of V squared. Next step, divide both sides by a half. And when doing so, that gives me 2GH equals V squared. And then the last step is just to square root both sides again. And that was V equals root 2GH. Now, by doing so, I've proved that velocity does not depend on mass at all.
And well done for making it to the end of today's video. Leo and I are both incredibly grateful for you joining us. Now, we'll be listening to loads of feedback on this, particularly around pace, around the quality of the visuals and all stuff like that. I am conscious, you know, I've not recorded and edited in a very long time, so we'll monitor that feedback and improve week in, week out. If you do need any extra support with tuition or home education, or if you want us to come into your school and support you, then please, please get in touch. The link is there to seethemountain.com, and I'll see you on the next one. Thank you.